the YBC Movies Podcast. I'm your host, Ron Houghton. Joining me today, as always, we've got Darren.
Hello.
And Paul.
Hola.
Today we're going to be talking about the Star Wars Disney Plus series, Ahsoka.
War is inevitable. One must destroy in order to create. We are no Jedi.
I started hearing whispers of Thrawn's return as heir to the Empire.
What happens when we find Thrawn?
Power, such as you've never dreamed.
Ahsoka was created by Dave Filoni. It stars Rosaria Dawson, David Tennant, Mary Elizabeth Winstead, and Ray Stevenson. I'll give you the IMDb plot. After the fall of the Galactic Empire, former Jedi Knight Ahsoka Tano investigates an emerging threat to the vulnerable galaxy. Hey guys.
Hey.
Long time no see you again. Gonna be playing catch up for a little bit here.
A little bit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
trying to get our schedules.
Life gets in the way sometimes.
Yeah,
but damn it, life finds a way.
That's right. I don't know what's really happened since we've been gone. The writer's strike is over. That's good news.
But the acting strike is ongoing.
Yeah, hopefully that will be resolved really soon.
And I knew they intended to make a new Planet of the Apes trilogy. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that they were so done filming the first one that the first trailer dropped today.
Did you watch it?
Yeah.
It looks great.
It looks great. I was shocked to see what they've already got one.
Yeah, I knew
that far along.
Next year, there was probably so much post CGI work to do that the acting had to be done so far. In
yeah,
that looks really good.
It looks fantastic.
Continuation of that whole Matt Reeves trilogy.
Yeah,
is it actually a continuation?
Oh yeah,
it's the same world. It looks like, but farther into the future.
Right, really gearing up for what became the 68 original version.
Yeah. That's awesome. Because my fear was that they were just gonna do another reboot of it, but that Matt Reeves trilogy is so strong that why would you not use that as a foundation to build on?
And it ends beautifully. Like you almost see the exact same locale that they're going to be using in the future Charlton Heston movie.
Mm-hmm.
It looks really good.
Nice.
I'm also looking forward to that Monarch series, which continues the Godzilla verse.
Mm-hmm.
That's coming out on Apple this month. Kurt Russell stars in it.
And so does his baby boy.
Oh, really? Wyatt Russell's in it?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Plays a younger version of Kurt Russell's character, ironically.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Oh, that's funny. those are two universes I really enjoy. So hopefully they can make some good shows out of that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I have trust in Apple TV. They're not afraid to throw money and budget at something. So I'm really looking forward to that.
Yeah, me too. Okay, let's talk about the new Star Wars show. I'll just give you my brief thoughts on it. I enjoyed it, but out of all the Star Wars shows, it's probably my least favorite, simply because there's so many new characters for me. Someone who hasn't seen all the animated stuff, I was just trying to play catch up for a little bit. You know, who are these people and what are their relationships? Obviously, you guys didn't have that homework to do. What did you guys think of it?
Well, I'll be honest with you. I was really curious. It's always interesting watching something coming from a point of knowledge where, essentially this is Rebels season 5. And I was really curious to see how well it played for somebody that wasn't as familiar with these characters. So I was really looking forward to catching up with you on it, because I know, you're not familiar with Ahsoka and some of these other, you know, band of heroes. So for me, I thought, that's a nice little throwaway line. That'll probably give people who haven't watched it enough context to know what's going on. But maybe that really wasn't the case. Like when they just have a throwaway line of, hey, that's Kanan Jarrus. I mean, clearly that's a character that means something to me, but not really anything to anybody else, right? So I loved this show. There were so many things that were high watermarks for Star Wars for me, like the flashback of Ahsoka through in episode 5, where it shows Ahsoka through the ages and you're getting to see her in the Clone Wars. So you're getting, as an animation fan, you're seeing some of the things you've seen only previously animated there.
She's basically a teenager in that series, right?
Yeah, she grows up as the Padawan of Anakin. And I thought they brought some, not only did they have the cool rebel stuff that I loved, but they brought some really interesting other things into the show too, like Baylan and Shin.
That was the Ray Stevenson character?
Yeah.
And I really like the villains in this show.
Yeah. And there was so many things that I thought they did really well in this show that they expanded on our knowledge of the Force. They did some really weird things, which I kind of like weird Star Wars. I know there's some people that the Force is the Force, but I like expanding on an idea and kind of bringing new things to the table. Otherwise, just kind of retelling the same stories, right? So I love the cast. I love the way it looked, and I loved a lot of the concepts it brought to the table. And we've got a galaxy far, 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 far away now.
Even farther.
Yeah.
Darren.
I liked it a lot too, Paul. Yeah, I hadn't thought of that either, about the context of someone unfamiliar with Rebels, how they'd react. Because now that you guys are, you know, we're all talking about this and looking back on it, even the character of Ezra, who's the main character of Rebels, he's the one that they rescue in the other galaxy.
Right, that's the one they're after on the planet.
Yeah. They don't even explain his story very well.
Not
in this.
At all. No. For me.
You don't get it. You really need to watch Rebels to get
it's
his full story.
Someone that they care about, that they want to save. That's really all I.
Yeah.
And you don't know how he's there.
No.
So for us, it's just added context of other things going on that you're like, oh, well, that's cool. But yeah, if you don't know how he's there, why he's there. When they revealed him, I assumed you'd get a little bit of catch-up dialogue. But having watched it, I already knew. So I guess I missed it.
Yeah. I mean, good for us. We didn't have to sit through a bunch of exposition, but. For people who didn't watch Rebels, it's well, guess they're old friends. Huh?
And how were the characters for you guys brought to life from the animated show? I think Ahsoka, for me, comes across a little humorless. I know she's a Jedi.
I thought that was on purpose at the beginning.
Yeah.
Because she's been through a lot. And yes, she had that very stoic demeanor. But there is that turn in episode 5. And I felt like that was really a pivotal turn for the character. Because I thought she seemed a lot looser and a lot more free after that. Not getting into spoilers as to what happens in that episode, but you felt like she had the weight of past decisions and past events on her. And then episode 5 happened and she seemed, her conscience was a little more free. So I felt like, I thought she did a great job.
What is she really struggling with though in the show?
Well, there's one main thing that, I don't know if you find this, Paul, I think they always kind of gloss over the fact that they just refer to her as a Jedi, but she's not.
She's not.
In, was it season 5?
Season 4 or 5.
Of the Clone Wars. She was accused by the Jedi Council of a crime that she was innocent of. And by the time it was all revealed and her innocence was proven, she said, screw this, I'm done with the Jedi Order. Right. Sayonara, and she left. So she's not a Jedi. She's a great Force user, extremely skilled and knowledgeable and smart. But
did she ever finish her training with Anakin, like as a fully formed Jedi, or was that kind of broken up?
No, like not as she left. Yeah, like that was it. That was the end of her training. There was no more. She's not a Jedi, and she's taken her own path.
There's a very famous line from her that says, "I am no Jedi." And there's a line, and I can't remember what point in this show one of the characters said something about you stink of Jedi, and I thought, well, that's funny because she's not. But there was another person, I think it was Baylan, was right there. He's a former Jedi, so you're probably, I think it was one of the Night Sisters, said you reek of Jedi, and it's like,
well,
he's
the traitor, so
well, exactly, right? So
there's a couple of things, maybe minor, that I didn't like about it. One is, I don't know if I like the idea that the Night Sisters, whatever they're called, of Dathomir, that they originated in this far off galaxy.
Was it like the witches?
Yeah, the witches. I like the idea better that they're from the main Star Wars galaxy.
I think they got abandoned there.
I thought they mentioned a line like, oh no, we first came from there. I could be remembering wrong.
I might have got that wrong, but they are from Dathomir because you get to experience them. Well, you see them in Clone Wars.
Yeah.
They're on Dathomir. Maybe that is.
But I thought that's what they said in this show, is that they.
That's their origin.
We came to Dathomir from this distant galaxy. Yeah,
maybe. I might have missed
which,
it. I've only watched the one.
Yeah, which if I'm right about that, then that's something I'm less fond of as a Star Wars point of lore. The other thing is that I really hate Chopper. Can't stand Chopper.
Chopper is
the fucking droid. I hate Chopper.
David Tennant.
I hate no. The stupid astromech droid with an orange.
All you hear is like
Dave Filoni does the voice of him, and I created him, and I think he thinks it's funny, and I think he enjoys doing the voice. But I hate Chopper. I wish Chopper would have been chopped up into bits at some point in this series. I hope he gets destroyed at some point. Aside from that, there was a lot to like about this show.
I will say. Like or hate Chopper, I do like that each Star Wars property brings a different droid and a different personality to the droid. Like you had Hu Yang, which was Ahsoka's sidekick,
the David Tennant,
voiced by David
Tennant. And he's been in the shows before. I don't remember. I have to kind of look some of these up. And like they're talking about him as if we should know him, and then like, okay, yeah, he was in the Clone Wars before.
Yeah,
but
he was in the Clone Wars cartoon, and he was the teacher that helped all the young Padawans build their lightsabers, which is why at one point in the story, you see him in the ship. He's got his store of tools and such to build the lightsabers. So that's where he came from. I had to remember where he was from.
Yeah,
like some of these shows, sure, I watched them, but it was like 8 years ago. So
yeah, when I was 15, I would have been so into Star Wars, I'd remember all this stuff, but I don't keep up with it anymore.
Yeah.
So.
But I do really like that, yeah, they do bring not only different designs of droids to each series, but like a different attitude. Like each droid has a personality. It's not just another C-3PO, another R2-D2. Like,
yeah, well, that would get pretty boring.
Yeah, they do a good job with those. I thought David Tennant was great.
The one from Rogue One.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
K-2SO. Yeah.
And something you alluded to before, like with the witches and some of these temples that we've seen, obviously they're hinting at these older Star Wars stories that we haven't seen before, and these, you know, all of these backstories that I really know nothing about. But I am pretty intrigued by it. There is talks of making some actual shows, right? Set in the earliest part of
I mean, of course, there's video games and stuff in that, and comic books. And I think, some novels, right? That are. Yeah, I mean, I'm not really that familiar with, I haven't read enough of the Star Wars books to know, but yeah, I'm really, that idea of the history of the Star Wars galaxy really fascinates
me. There's enough meat out there that they could easily do a whole series.
I've said before, like, I'm sick of the same 40-year time frame that we've been given for Star Wars. Let's find out what happened 4,000 years ago.
That era is called the High Republic. Apparently, there was a couple nods to potential things in here. I don't know any of it, so it would have been lost on me. But yeah, I'm so on board with exploring different eras. I love the Skywalker saga for the most part, but there's more stories to be told.
Disney is so focused on their Resistance era storytelling. And I don't like the Resistance era Star Wars stories. I just can't help but see it as them shitting all over George Lucas and what his plans were, and Kathleen Kennedy and J.J. Abrams thinking they knew better and definitely did not know better.
Well, in the shows, you're getting it from somebody that was mentored by Lucas, and there's a stark difference in storytelling.
Well, exactly. Like, I mean, Book of Boba Fett and Mandalorian lead up to Resistance era Star Wars, and it's great storytelling. Because it's from Dave Filoni and Jon Favreau, who I think are true Star Wars fans as opposed to fanboys, maybe, if I can throw that at J.J. Abrams and Rian Johnson and what they came up with, which they just butchered the Skywalker saga, if you ask me. Those movies came for people who didn't understand the character of Luke Skywalker, is the most basic way I could put it. Yeah. But having said that, there are good stories that are still being told, like Ahsoka. And to finally get back to what you said, like the casting, Ron. I think Hera, Mary Elizabeth Winstead is great. The young man who's playing Ezra looked, when you first see him in that sort of hologram transmission, I was like, wow, did they get someone who looks like the animated Ezra? And then what's her name? The graffiti girl.
Sabine.
Holy shit, does she look like Sabine? Yeah, so I mean, just wonderful casting. And they're nailing the characters anyways.
My favorite character on the show is, and favorite performance is the guy who plays Grand Admiral Thrawn.
Yeah.
He's a delicious villain. Yeah.
That's a great character and a great performance.
So he's that cool in the show?
He's that cool in the show. The limited amount I've read him in books and comics, I love that he's the antithesis of Vader. We all love Vader, but he was emotional. He was reactionary. Thrawn is anything but. He's calculating. He's measured. He will accept a defeat if it's for a greater good. He will study a culture to understand how to get under their skin and defeat them. He's amazing. I fucking love Thrawn.
Like,
He's perfect, so that it's not just a retread of a villain.
Yeah, and I'm not sure which actor is playing him, actually.
I've looked it up, but now I can't remember.
He's the brother of somebody.
Famous brother? Randy Quaid?
Yes.
That's exactly.
Fassbender.
One of the Bridges. He's got to be one of the Bridges.
One of the Baldwins.
that's more like it.
Yeah, I love him as a villain.
You get the best out of him so far is in, we talked about before we started recording, the Heir to the Empire novel trilogy, first published in the early 90s.
Okay.
That's where he made his debut. And that whole trilogy revolves around his holding together the remnants of the Empire 5 years after Return of the Jedi and really almost bringing them back up strong enough again to take down the New Republic. That's a great trilogy. If you like the character of Thrawn, to anyone out there, read the Heir to the Empire trilogy.
First live action appearance, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
He appeared in the last, maybe the last two, but definitely the last season of Rebels. And that's the first experience I had with him. And I started reading the book that Darren just mentioned, Heir to the Empire, which is an amazing introduction to the character for sure.
Yeah. I got to say, when I was watching the show, like I said, Ahsoka seemed sort of humorless and a bit dull to me. Some of the other characters like Sabine and Hera were okay. okay, but like I didn't really connect with them. And then the villains popped up, and like Ray Stevenson and his little sidekick.
That's just so sad that Ray Stevenson cannot come back as Balin.
Yeah, he nailed it.
Yeah.
And that's for me when the show kind of came alive.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Right. Yeah, like, of course.
But yeah, you're right. Like the villains really drive the show. And then this, I just found out because of a deep dive on kind of the lore and behind some of these characters. Dave Filoni is obsessed with wolves. Like his character is Trapper Wolf. The characters of Balin and Shin are actually based out of Norse mythology, where Balin is cursed to be chasing the sun for eternity, and Shin is cursed to be chasing the moon for eternity. And you can tell the influence in their costumes too. Like they've got that very medieval Norse look.
Very interesting.
Yeah, and as far as the villains go, then you have like the witches of Dathomir, who just another exploration of the Force in the Star Wars universe. It's not just Jedi and Sith. There's these other things out there. I still go on about the Clone Wars. I have problems with Rebels, although there's great things in Rebels. But the Clone Wars, such good storytelling in that show, and that's where we first see the witches of Dathomir. And that's the same planet, for those who don't know, that Darth Maul and his culture come from. So you've got this all-male and this all-female that are both kind of evil and dark force users, but they don't get along and they're stuck on the same planet together and they're always at each other's throats. And then you have this other aspect too that was explored by Ahsoka. I mean, Paul will remember it was one of these really cool things about Rebels when Ahsoka almost drowns or dies and she goes into this sort of like meta space. Yeah, world between worlds with these paths between doors to times and dimensions and planets. I had some problems with some of the juvenilia of Rebels, but that was one of the great things about Rebels is the way it explored these other aspects of the Force, like this weird world, like just the way Dave Filoni has come up with some of these things.
I would say Rebels' highs were as high as Clone Wars highs.
Yeah, it unfortunately had more lows, but it had some great highs.
And I liked it more than you did, but yeah, exactly. Like the stuff where Ahsoka faces Vader, like that is incredible storytelling.
Yeah, that's why I don't think... To me, I was more disappointed when Rebels dipped more towards the juvenile side of Star Wars storytelling, because Clone Wars never really got too juvenile. It kind of kept it at a mature level, but when Rebels did things like that, you know, and then there was the final fate of Darth Maul, we find that out in Rebels. Look it up just to find that if you're interested in Darth Maul's ultimate fate, because it is perfect.
Yeah, it is.
It is perfect.
And if you ever wonder if Dave Filoni is truly the person to handle Star Wars, look up on YouTube his explanation of why Duel of the Fates was so pivotal. Yeah. It's incredible.
Yeah, I've seen that.
Yeah, it blew my mind. I was like, yeah, maybe I don't understand Star Wars. Right? Like, it's just
another level. Like, he should be making all the creative decisions behind Star Wars.
Yeah.
Is there any spoilers that we want to talk about? I'm not even sure what's a spoiler.
You mean things that we haven't ruined already in the last 20 minutes?
No. Obviously, there's a big cameo that's a big spoiler.
Yeah.
So that's about the only one I could think of that would be...
Well, and there's a little spoiler at the end, but it's kind of a deep dive as to where the show may be going.
Right.
I agree. Like, the biggest spoiler is the cameo in episode 5.
So, I'm sure spoiler alert, everyone.
Yeah, we can let it go.
If you've made it this far.
Yeah, if you're interested in Star Wars, you probably know about it beforehand, like I did. Hayden Christensen returns as Anakin Skywalker.
So great to see him involved again and seeing him able to portray the character beyond kind of that stiff and robotic portrayal in the prequels, because I don't know how you felt there, but I thought it was so refreshing to see him play this era of Anakin, be free, be kind of charming, and really embodying what we knew of the character in animation, because that is the weird thing about Anakin, is that I really grew to love the character of Anakin more through the animation portrayals than the movie portrayals, because he just was so stiff and rigid in the movies. And I understand that was a performance and directorial choice, but it played way better in the animated series for sure.
Yeah, he does come across that way in this show too, more Clone Wars-like. And I love seeing Hayden Christensen, the way he's showing up in this and Obi-Wan Kenobi. Bring on more of him. Be happy to explore more of that character for sure.
Yeah. The central theme of Ahsoka, again, like most Star Wars stuff, seems to be master and apprentice, master and apprentice. It's all over the place.
Yeah.
They're obviously going to spend a bit of time on her.
Well, and then there's
this relationship.
Yeah. And there's things like, I mean, we've talked about Ray Stevenson. There's obviously something big going on with that character that's not finished up yet. So I'm sorry to say they do need to recast it, because that character's not done. I mean, Ray Stevenson was great. I'm sure they can find other great actors that can take it up and maybe put a little different twist on it. But we need to see what was going on, because there was obviously something he's doing, something he's planning that is just kind of left And they were mm-hmm. like, yeah, well, we'll get to that in season two.
By the time I got to the finale and the expectation of what's coming, I was pretty excited. Mm-hmm. I mean, I got more involved as the show went along. And like I said, it's all the villains for me. So what are the villains up to?
Well, and there's a pretty big hint as to what Balin's actually trying to do. But there's one of the final shots of the series. You see him kind of on this precipice, and you see there's three statues there, of which one is crumbled. And that, again, to beat a dead horse, is a throwback to a Clone Wars, I think it was 2 or 3 episode story arc, where it's the father, the son, and the daughter, and the father represented the balance in the Force. The son was the dark side, and the daughter was the light side.
Great story arc. Yeah. Like, honestly, if you don't want to sit through all the Clone Wars, look up those episodes on Disney Plus. It's just brilliant storytelling. Yeah. And another weird side about the Force that is not just Jedi and Sith.
Yeah. Which series? Clone Wars?
Clone Wars. So that is something that came from George Lucas's brain, because he wasn't really involved in Rebels, but he approved everything in Clone Wars.
I completely forgot. George Lucas created Ahsoka. In my brain, it's Dave Filoni. No, George Lucas was behind the first Clone Wars movie, which was where Ahsoka first made her appearance.
And where, I can't remember where I saw this recently. Maybe it was they had a brief kind of on Disney Plus introduction to Ahsoka, like a little 15-minute thing or 10-minute thing, whatever it was. And I can't remember if that's where I read this or heard this, but Dave Filoni said George Lucas kind of forced Ahsoka on him. He said, well, let's give they kind of sort of created this character who was, you know, the same species as Shaak Ti, the Jedi. You see a little bit in the prequel trilogy. Her death scene is cut from Revenge of the Sith. But anyways, he says, well, let's make her Anakin's apprentice. Dave Filoni said to George Lucas, well, Anakin doesn't have an apprentice. George said, yeah, he does. And so,
end of discussion.
Yeah, so now in the Clone Wars. And why not? We hadn't seen any of the Clone Wars. And now there's a, 5 or 6 year time frame in which Anakin could have an apprentice. And what a character they created. And look what legacy she's created. So
she's quickly become one of my favorite Star Wars characters.
You can't stand her in the first couple seasons of the Clone War because she's an obnoxious adolescent, and she's supposed to be. And then, like you said, she becomes the stoic, humorless person based on her life experiences. Rosario Dawson is perfect casting for her, we've said before.
The overall fan reaction to the show, I have no idea. But...
Well, they've already gone ahead and announced season two will happen, right? So it must have been well enough.
Who knows? Maybe the fan casting of Liv Schreiber as Balin will actually happen. Good actor.
You know what? I can see that. I can see that.
All right. Any other final thoughts on the show?
Well, I have lots, but you know, we don't have enough tape.
Exactly. I guess we geeked out too long.
I mean, I'm glad I knew you guys would enjoy it more than I did.
Try and watch some of those like Clone Wars and Rebels bits and pieces before watching it again.
Send me a list of essential episodes.
I think if you go to, is it StarWars.com or Disney.com, and you look up essential lists, they actually have like essential viewing lists.
Down to what? 2 or 3 dozen? Okay. Let's move on to our rant and rave section. This is where we each talk about what we've all been watching lately. I'll start with a quick Disney trio. They're all remakes, essentially. The Little Mermaid, Haunted Mansion, and Peter Pan and Wendy. I didn't like them all, by the way.
I was going to say, you sat through all three of those?
I got to fess up right away. I didn't make it through The Little Mermaid. I got through about 40 minutes of it and turned it off. I thought it was just awful. For someone who loves the original animated movie, I saw it a couple times in the theater when it came out. I've always said that my big gripe is it just lacks any of the magic that these cartoons have. And who wants to see a realistic flounder and a realistic Sebastian the Crab?
Exactly. I mean,
without any of the animated emotion that those characters have, you can exaggerate their characteristics and stuff and bulging eyeballs and things like that, make them fun. When they bring them to the live action world, it's none of that. You're just watching a crab with a voice to it. I thought it was a really sort of lifeless remake. I really didn't like it. And I think the lead actor's performance is weak. And the director, it's directed by a guy named Rob Marshall, who's sort of a big acclaimed director of a lot of things, but I'm not a fan of him.
He's a big musical director too.
Chicago and Les Mis. And
Memoirs of a Geisha too, didn't he direct?
Just not a fan of this guy's work, and this one I think stinks.
Stinks like a dead flounder.
The Haunted Mansion movie I didn't like much either. It's better than that Eddie Murphy one that they came out with like 20 years ago. It does have a certain style to it and atmosphere, but I found it has too much plot. Too many characters to care about. Doesn't bring back any of the fun of the ride. And not really scary. Sort of a dull horror movie. Yeah, didn't like it. And then Peter Pan and Wendy. Out of the three, maybe it's the one I enjoyed the most. Still not much. No. Mm-hmm. It's directed by this guy, David Lowery, who made this movie called The Green Knight a few years ago.
Oh, yeah.
Which I really enjoyed visually. This movie, too, has a pretty good visual design, too. Jude Law is interesting as Captain Hook. I think everyone's pretty good when they're playing that character. You can just chew up the scenery with that guy. But the kid that they got to play Peter Pan is weak in this, and the acting or all the kids in it are not memorable.
Yeah, as far as these Disney live action remakes go, I've personally stuck to the ones that have got good reviews. Mm. And I haven't been disappointed. Like, I've really enjoyed The Jungle Book, Cinderella. I think maybe the only other one I saw was Beauty and the Beast, which I think didn't translate to live act very well.
I thought much like Little Mermaid, it was just a by the numbers.
Yeah, it's like a fairy tale kind of thing where it works so well in animation, but you just don't buy, or I didn't buy. I know she has to fall in love with him.
Yeah.
But there's no motivation. There's nothing to fall in love with there other than, okay, I guess he's not evil, but he's still a prick who, you know, locked up her father, locked her up, kicked all these people out of his castle. He's an asshole. Oh, he's learned to be a better person. Okay, that's maybe a little admirable. It's not enough to fall in love with. Then they stuffed it with stuff about her father hiding the past about what happened to her mother from her. There's no reason to not tell her what happened to her mother. It's just stuff in the plot. And so, yeah, I don't know. Like Pinocchio, I mean, I love Robert Zemeckis, but I don't know if I could sit through this Pinocchio.
Oh, it's bad.
I look forward to Gargoyles as if it is indeed Kenneth Branagh doing it. I think between him and
Jordan Peele,
who was the other person whose name came up earlier. I think either one of them could do a great Gargoyles. You just don't need to Aladdin from Guy Ritchie. I don't even get that.
That one made a lot of money.
It did make a pile.
No. I don't know their fascination with these, and they're
Dumbo. I guess. I mean, the first Alice Wonderland from Tim Burton was good. I did enjoy that.
Yeah, it had some good visuals.
Very different.
It was also Tim Burton.
Tim Burton to make it. Wasn't just a by the numbers remake of the animated.
Tim Burton did Dumbo too. That was a movie that I thought about half of it worked.
Yeah, that's not a movie that
all the extra stuff was just.
It's perfect at an hour.
Yeah,
in the animated form to stuff it to 90 minutes or 2 hours
to make it more about the family than the elephant.
Just stupid.
And even something like Haunted Mansion doing movies for their rides now.
Jungle Cruise, I guess, in that regard, I kind of enjoyed. That was fun.
I was just gonna say Jungle Cruise. Yeah. I actually had a pretty good time with. Yeah. So if you're thinking Haunted Mansion is in that level, it's not. They couldn't even get as good as the Jungle Cruise.
And of all the Disney attractions that should be rife for a good movie, let someone be creative and come up with a good story set around the idea of the Haunted Mansion, and you got a winner.
I think they thought they had one. it's too much of a muddled plot for me. It's like after half an hour, it's kind of like, who's who and what should I care about? And get on with the scares. That never really happened. Yeah, so those are three Disney movies I think you can pass on.
All right.
Strike one, two, three.
You're up.
Next batter. What did you want to talk about, Paul?
Well, seeing as, you know, we're talking Star Wars, I figured I'd carry that on. I'm going to talk about two animated series that are on Disney Plus. First off, Tales of the Jedi Season 1. This is 6 short episodes centered around Count Dooku and Ahsoka. Really short episodes. Like, I feel like they're 8 to 10 minutes. Easy to sit through. And it's really interesting character explorations. Like, you see Ahsoka from a baby and kind of see the genesis of some of her abilities and some of her powers, which I thought was fun because I love the character. I'll take any kind of extra content I can about her. But I found the stuff about Count Dooku was really interesting because it's, aside from being a villain, you don't know much about his Jedi days. Like, why did he turn on the Jedi and what pushed him away from the Jedi Council? Mm-hmm. Well, and they explore bits of that in this series, and you see him interacting with, like, Qui-Gon Jinn and kind of see the effect of Qui-Gon Jinn's death on Count Dooku and how that played an effect on him. And so they kind of bring in some of these story elements that you know very well from the prequels and from these characters' pasts, but then they add a little bit more context to it and background. So yeah, it's a easy-to-digest series that if you want a little bit more Star Wars, it's right up there. I loved it, and it's the same kind of animation style as Clone Wars, and it's from Filoni.
I haven't watched it yet. I'm very interested, so yeah. I gotta get on it.
Really good. And then number two, I've talked about my high anticipation for this season of Star Wars Visions, and I was really hoping that season two was more of a global approach to what Star Wars means to different cultures, not just anime, and that's exactly what it was. Like, it's brilliant. I think there was only one, was there eight or nine episodes? Nine episodes. I think there was only one episode that I was kind of lukewarm to, and funny enough, that was the one anime one. But I loved the animation studios that they picked. Cartoon Saloon did one, Aardman did one, but they had a bunch of other animation studios that I had heard the name of, but hadn't really recognized where I knew it from. Studios from Spain, France, Ireland, Chile, England, South Korea, India, Japan, and South Africa. I love how different people are going to bring a completely different context and vision as to what Star Wars means to them. And not only their vision of what Star Wars is, but how they portray that. And you get so many varied animation styles. Like, there's one, it's from South Africa, and it's almost like cloth stop motion. It almost reminded me of that old Jeremy the Bear cartoon from when we were kids animation. The tones go everywhere from just kind of goofy, which you would expect from like an Aardman, to something that's got a little bit more grit and depth and darkness to it. Yeah, I loved it. It was exactly what I wanted it to be. Just a little bit more of an open-eyed look through a bunch of different lenses, and it's fantastic. I loved it. There are episodes in season one I would rewatch, but aside from that one episode in season two, I'd watch them all again.
Yeah, there's some really good season one episodes, some bad episodes.
Yeah.
That rock band episode ranks among the worst Star Wars productions. And it's Christmas special level of bad. Yeah.
But not even that enjoyable.
Well, at least that had some camp to it, right? Yeah. This just was awful. And to say that, my kids loved that episode. But yeah, I look forward to season two as well.
And it's not canon. It's not linked to any lore, so they can do whatever they want.
Sounds cool.
Yeah.
Okay, Darren, what do you got?
All right, well, I'll start with one of my show and tells. Quentin Tarantino's Cinema Speculation.
I've got that on order on paperback.
Oh. It's a great book. What it is, it's Quentin Tarantino's only other book aside from the companion book to Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. This is about a lot of things. It's about his favorite movies from the 70s. Big surprise. But aside from that, it's kind of got three components to it. It's got the autobiographical stuff, like about his life growing up in the 60s and 70s in Los Angeles, going to movies with his mom and his former stepdad, and then his mom's friends and her sometime boyfriends, and what it was like going to the different theaters, going to the theaters on Sunset Boulevard, going to theaters in the black neighborhoods of Los Angeles, and the differences in the audience, how they reacted to movies. And then there's the discussions of the movies themselves. These are some of his favorite movies of all time. He's talking about in this book, like Taxi Driver and Rolling Thunder. Blowout comes up. The Getaway. Anyways, so you get the Quentin Tarantino movie geekness there. He's just going on about what he loves about these movies, but he's also critical about all of them too, and he doesn't mind telling you what he doesn't like about them and what he doesn't think worked. And because he's such a nerd, he's researched them and he knows all this trivia about them, and that's all fascinating to read. The third kind of component of it is he's now a Hollywood insider himself, being the big director he is. He's talked to and interviewed John Milius and Walter Hill and Peter Bogdanovich and Paul Schrader and Martin Scorsese, and he's got all this insider's information about who was originally cast in these films, who was going to direct it, what the first tone was going to be like until they filmed it, and what got changed from the screenplay to when they shot it. Fascinating stories. They're all told in that sort of Quentin Tarantino know-it-all movie geek stream of consciousness kind of way he has of talking. If you've seen any of his interviews, that's how he writes this book. Mm-hmm. So it's fascinating to listen to. You can picture his voice talking throughout the whole book. And aside from those chapters on the movies, there's kind of side chapters on his favorite critic. I can't remember his name now, and I'm not going to flip through the book and find it, but he was a second string critic for the LA Times in the 70s, and he was the only one, he was the only mainstream critic in all of America who took exploitation and B-movies seriously and didn't act as if it was a chore or a punishment to have to sit through them and review them. And he had genuinely thoughtful things to say about grindhouse movies.
That critic that he's talking about could be very well the main character of his next and final movie.
Exactly, yeah. And
because it's supposed to be a 1970s film critic, and it's a guy.
Exactly. And I don't doubt there's a major influence there.
Yeah.
And there's a chapter about Floyd. Floyd was the ex-boyfriend of his mom's best friend. And then he rented a room from Quentin and his mom for a year. When Quentin was 15, 16, he was an adult who could match Quentin Tarantino in movie geekness and movie trivia. And he took him seriously in his opinions. And he was obviously a big influence on Quentin as well. I didn't want this book to end. I could have read 10 more chapters. It's wonderful. For movie fans and or Quentin Tarantino fans, cinema speculation. Wonderful book.
I'm glad you enjoyed it because this is what he might be doing now for the rest of
his
life.
If he truly makes only one more movie but writes books afterwards, yeah, I look forward to all those books.
Yeah, I can't wait to get it. I don't know why I didn't order it on hardcover. It looks like a nice copy.
I didn't even know about it. Megan got it for me for my birthday and sat on the shelf not too long until I read it, and very good.
You're ahead of me on this one. I'm jealous.
Yeah, you'll get to it very soon, I'm sure.
Yeah, I will.
And I guess for my second rant and or rave of the evening, the movie is called Fall.
I was curious about this one.
From
see that in the theater.
Yeah. From 2022, almost like a confined space movie, but it's a pretty open confined space. It's about two young women who, after certain tragedy in a life, a shared experience, they kind of reconnect after a year and go to climb this, I assume, fictional, old, defunct television broadcast tower in deserts of California. They say it's over a mile high or something. I can't remember the height, but I felt the height watching this movie at times.
And these are obviously two girls who climb stuff, right?
They are mountain climbers and experienced climbers. Anyways, it's written by Jonathan Frank and Scott Mann, directed by Scott Mann, stars Grace Carolyn Curry, Virginia Gardner as the two girls, Mason Gooding as Grace's husband, and Jeffrey Dean Morgan as Grace's father. He's kind of the only real familiar face in the movie for me anyways. Yeah, it was pretty good. The opening 20 minutes had a little bit of bad acting in it. There's a few plot contrivances of their personal lives that may seem a little obvious and you may roll your eyes at a little bit, but the fun of the movie is seeing them. But the point is they get so high in the tower, and it's a rusty old, not well maintained broadcast tower, and I'm talking like twice the size of the Eiffel Tower, if not more. It's really high up, vertigo inducing, really dangerous. The rusty old ladder breaks off beneath them, and they have no way of getting down, and they're in the desert, and so they have to find
one way down.
Yeah, well, they have to find use their ingenuity to try and find ways to maybe contact people, maybe signal people, maybe get down somehow. And I won't, of course, ruin how it plays out. But there's a lot of fun in their predicament. And
my palms are getting sweaty just thinking about it.
Yeah, I mean, I'm one who's my insides have shriveled up playing video games where I've got a bird's eye view and have to jump from one cliff to the other. So, I mean, watching a movie with like well done height special effects.
Could you have sat in a movie theater and watched this?
Yeah, I mean, I don't personally get vertigo. It's just like I get a little antsy about heights.
Yeah, I was having problems even on my TV. And even though I know all the trickery and I know exactly how they probably filmed it using screens and everything, the girls were never that high.
Yeah.
It's still.
And it's well done. It looks good.
Psychologically, I can't block out. And I was like,
oh, that's
feeling a little nauseous moments.
Like I said, if I can get that way from a video game, modern, great special effects, I feel the height.
Yeah, I don't know if I particularly enjoyed watching it. More as I got through it.
You endured it.
Yeah, exactly. But it is, it's an experience. I like movies like that.
Yeah, it's not a masterpiece, but it's definitely fun. You know, it's like a lot of movies this nature. It's 90 minutes. It's on Netflix, so it's available to anyone who has Netflix.
I'd recommend it too, even if you have a fear of heights.
Especially if you have a fear of heights.
Yeah, makes it more fun.
Conquer that fear. Yeah, I was curious from seeing the trailer for this. I was exactly that, looking for that. You're right. Like, it's almost like an experience more than a movie where you're kind of enduring it with the characters.
Yeah.
I was looking for that. That's what I was hoping it would be.
So. Yeah, like I said, on a recent episode, I've watched a lot of documentaries recently about, like, you know, free climbers, and I mean, those are some tough that's not special effects, right. That's real drone footage and so on.
Watching Free Solo was
Free Solo just, especially
gave me the same thing.
It's so if you like something like that, it's the fictional version. It's fun. Like I said, the opening 15 minutes is not great acting there. Some overacting, but whatever,
you're just waiting for him to get up
You're waiting for the tower, and then then you get the juicy stuff. It's good.
Exactly. Okay, lots of recommendations there. I guess three thumbs up for Ahsoka for sure. Yep. The more Star Wars fan you are, the more you enjoy
the more so.
Okay, that's it for today. Next time we're going to be back to discuss the new mystery thriller, A Haunting in Venice. Until then, you can give us a like and subscribe to our Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram accounts. And if you want to search out our past reviews, you can always look up a film on our website, why we see movies at lipson.com. Thanks for listening, and take care.
Farewell.
Ciao, Sky Guy.